Well, folks, the topic this morning, it's easy to divide doubt. When your pastor and I were talking about what's an easy way to divide the sessions, I usually like to have three sessions and do factual, emotional, volitional. So we have a fourth one. The issue we're doing this morning is so big, so common, so regular. I'd say virtually every Christian not only doubts at some time, virtually every Christian has this objection at some time. And it is so common, and it has become, to me, the most common question I get dealing with the subject of doubt. And that is the question of the silence of God. And some ways to state the objection goes like this. You know, I've done everything the Bible's told me to do. I've memorized key verses. God says this and this and this, and I do it. And I don't know what the experience in Bill's life is, and I don't know what the experience in Karen's life is, but I'll tell you what, I don't see it. Now, I mean, does God not like me? Did I do the wrong thing? Did I not trust Christ? Did I not, I mean, what gives? Then, when I get together with other Christians, I find out that they're asking the same questions. How come it seems like God's absent in the world today? You know, what's going on? Is God ignoring me? And for those of you who were here yesterday, you know one of the biggest themes this weekend, which will come up in this PowerPoint, one of the biggest themes this weekend has been, watch what you say to yourself. What you say, and when I say what you say to yourself, I mean what you think. When something's happening and you go, oh no, and you're just around the house by yourself. Let's say you're going fishing tomorrow, you're playing golf, or you were whatever, and all of a sudden it starts storming like crazy and you hear it's going to be like that for 3 days. And all you say to yourself is, oh no. You didn't verbalize that, but you know what you mean by oh no. And that's a key, because so often we tell ourselves the wrong things about the Lord, and oh no could mean God blew it again. I don't say that, but I know what I mean. And again, what we were saying yesterday was the worst things that happen to you are not the actual events, but how you download them. How do you interpret? What do you say to yourself about what happens? And if you take almost everything as an opportunity to say to yourself, God let me down again. Didn't answer my prayer again. I told him it had to be by this Saturday, and the time's come and gone, and he's done nothing. What gives? That's not what this verse says. That's not what this verse says. My experience of God is not what the experience Scripture says. So what's happening? Now, with that idea in mind, what are you telling yourself? Even if it's the, oh, and you know what that means. Rain all weekend. The game was canceled. I can't go out with my friends tomorrow as I planned. Somebody canceled. You know, whatever that means, we do the same thing with God. And I want to know, what do you say to yourself, or do you even catch that when you do that with God? Because I think you deepen this negative experience. So let's go ahead and move into this. And first I want to say this. First of all, this is an exciting, exciting, exciting time to be alive. I wished I were beginning my career instead of on the backside of it, and I could learn a lot of the things that are going on today. The first point I want to make is God is incredibly active in the world today. Now, I want to say that up front, because when people say, well, I don't know where he is, I never see him, I want to make two sorts of comments about how active God is. I want to say, first of all, that God is present supernaturally in the world, because that's the kind, when people ask me, where is God, they generally mean one of two things. Where is God supernaturally? Where are these supernatural acts that they saw in the New Testament? And the second way they often mean this is, well, I don't care about supernatural. I just wonder where God is personally. Why doesn't he speak to me? Why doesn't he let me know what these issues are? So I want to take a minute here before we get into this and discuss two topics. Is God supernaturally present in the world today? And is God personally present in the world today? How do we know those two topics? And the overall theme is, if we miss this stuff and tell ourselves all the oh no's of our faith, we're going to get deeper into our despair over this question and not even realize that the answers are all around us, literally. I have a paper to give in just a couple weeks up in Milwaukee, a professional paper with professional philosophers. And they're Christians. It's a Christian philosophy conference. And what I want to say to them in this paper is, when we talk about Christian evidences, we usually mean things that happened in the first century, and how can our research affirm things way back then? That's usually what apologetics means. But I'm suggesting in this paper that there is a new typology of apologetics that's come about in the last 30 or 40 years, which consists of, you can do it without any reference to first century things. More evident areas of evidence have popped up in the last 25, 30 years that have come in any other short period of time. Now, why is this? I don't know. Maybe it's because apologetics, professional apologists, have gotten very, very specialized in the last few decades. Just 60, 70 years ago, the top apologists in the church were generalists. They were people who did apologetics plus a lot of other things, and they just generally addressed it. Today, the critiques about Christianity are so specific and the attacks are so strong that we have people who spend their entire life, say, studying the resurrection, or their entire life studying a particular argument for God's existence, or their entire life talking about morality and how we know morality has an absolute basis, and you have to account for that, and you can't account for it in a materialistic world. And things are happening today. In the last few years, some major thinkers, non-Christians, have said that naturalism is on the way out. The worldview that has run the Western university, say Western Europe, North America, Australia, for many, many decades, is now going. And another book just came out by the well-known distinguished philosopher Thomas Nagel, an atheist. And Nagel says, the subtitle of the book is Why Materialistic Neo-Darwinism is Almost Assuredly Incorrect. That's the subtitle. He's distinguished professor at large at New York University, and he serves in two departments, philosophy and law. Nice combination. So things are happening. And here's some of the things I just want you to know. God is alive and well on planet Earth, and we should keep that in background when we ask, why is God ignoring me? I don't know, but it's not because God's not here. God's around. For example, in recent years, there have been a lot of double-blind prayer experiments. I remember one crossed my desk as a chair of a philosophy department, and I saw this advertisement, and the top of the brochure was folded down, so I didn't see where it was. And I was looking down this brochure, and it said, what about healing in the world today? That's what the brochure said. What about healing? What about answers to prayer? What about angels and supernatural and so on and so on? I'm thinking, wow, who's sending me this brochure? It's probably some Christian group. Come study with us. And I flipped the top up, Harvard University School of Medicine. All right, that's not your normal advertisement from them. I was at a major school recently, an Ivy League school, and I was told about a professor, an atheistic philosopher, who, if I understand the story, became a Christian. Guess why? A world-renowned philosopher became a Christian because he had an encounter with an angel. Yep. No way. Just ask him what was going on. I don't know. Well, one thing, and this is one of the Harvard Medical School, the advertisement talked about, is there are a number of prayer experiments today. Double-blind prayer experiments, and the first one, the prototypical one, took place in a San Francisco hospital in the mid-1980s, and the cardiologist who was in charge was a man named Randolph Bird. They asked about 400 people if they wanted to participate in a prayer experiment, and they said, some of them would say normal things. Well, I'm an atheist, but I don't care if you pray for me. Like that. Okay, we'll put you on the list. And they got just short of 400 people. And then, I always wonder about the ethics of this. 400 people asked, sure, pray for me. And then the medical doctor did not know who was being prayed for and who wasn't. Half of them were prayed for and half of them were not. So he's like, yeah, pray for me, pray for me, pray for me, pray for me. Yes, yes, no, no way. Yes, yes, no. It's like, how come half of them aren't getting prayed for? Well, they surveyed these folks and they kept track of their health. They were cardiac patients. They kept track of their health and they monitored them in 26 medical categories. And the results of this, because the results were so staggering, they were published in a peer-reviewed medical journal. And the PRACY, if you can imagine this PRACY for the peer-reviewed medical journal, the last sentence of the paragraph summary of the article is, the people who were prayed for got statistically better in 21 out of 26 categories. Last sentence, the results of the study are consistent with prayer to the Judeo-Christian God. That was in a peer-reviewed medical journal. Why? Because the 17 people doing the praying were all Orthodox Christians. Now, this is like a little too much for PC, right? This came out 25 years ago, and I don't even know if you'd see this today, but it was the prototypical one. So now other prayer experiments have done, and it's hard for them to duplicate the results of this one, and science depends largely on duplication and some other things. They couldn't duplicate it. Well, one major school tried this, and they decided they wanted a PC group of prayers. So instead of using Orthodox prayers, they used medicine men, third world, this spiritual person, this guru, this. And this particular experiment, if you were prayed for, you were slightly worse off than those who weren't prayed for. And the ones who weren't prayed for got better a little faster. And they thought, well, what's going on here? All right, so more experiments were done, and nobody could back up this one from Randolph Bird from San Francisco. And finally, another one was found with 2,000 persons in Kansas City. And the results came out, published in another medical journal, statistically supporting prayer to the Judeo-Christian God, and all the prayers were Orthodox Christians. Now, I want to make something clear. I believe God answers prayers for unbelievers. I believe God heals unbelievers. He did it in biblical times. When people came to Jesus to be healed, he didn't say, believer, all right, no, get out of here. You know, he just healed, and it says he healed everybody in the town who came to him. I think God does those things. But the second one has these kind of results, and only Christian prayers, which caused a Duke University researcher to ask this question. After all these experiments, as far as I know, only three had positive results for prayers, and all three, the prayers, were evangelical Christians. And so this research from Duke University says, what? What is this? God only answers prayer for Christians? That was the researcher's question. That's not my view. I'm just saying things are happening statistically. That's the key in this first one. Statistically better in 21 out of 26 categories. Okay, that's one of the areas today. Next. I advertised this book all over the place. I already did it at the university the other day. Craig Keener, prominent New Testament scholar, PhD from Duke, with a minor in classical studies, Greco-Roman studies. And he has put together a two-volume set of works. If you're interested in this question, it's got to be on your shelf. It's the most captivating thing I've read in 5 years. In fact, I have to lead at the same philosophical conference in a couple weeks. I have to lead a whole panel with J.P. Moreland, some other guys, lead a whole panel on this. But Craig has collected hundreds of contemporary healing accounts. He puts them in this book with data. Many of them have backup, pre and post MRIs, pre and post CAT scans, pre and post x-rays. And some of the reports are just absolutely incredible, almost unbelievable. I'll tell you just one. This woman had to have her spleen removed for medical reasons. And they removed her spleen. She's a Christian. And she's at her church, and they're praying for her and laying hands on her and praying that she'd be healed from this surgery where she lost her spleen. She goes in for the post-op checkup, and she has a fully functioning spleen. Now, I just told this to a group of medical doctors the other day, and they looked at me like, these were guys in a medical school. And they went, okay. And I said, now, what do you do when you have pre and post data? Disease, spleen, no spleen, spleen. What do you do? And you say, well, that's not my experience. Okay, but it's somebody's. There's a little child who had to have a kidney removed. And they prayed over this child, these Christians, and when they went for the post-op checkup, the child had two kidneys. But get these books. They're the most incredible thing. I'll tell you just this one thing. I talk to agnostics all the time. I have guys that I witness with and chat with, and there's these two brothers from Canada, and we Skype for about an hour and a half every month. And I referred those two books to these guys, agnostics. They got the books, and next time they talked to me, they said, all right, we're agnostics, but the evidence in this book is just too much. We've got a confession to make. We now believe God heals people. So things are happening, and because of some of our scientific documentation, we're able to document these things better than we've ever been able to in the past. Next. The topic I just mentioned, I should have saved the testimony of that Ivy League professor for right here. By the way, I have a photograph of the angel. One of the guys sent it to me. He took it with his phone. Don't tell me. I just collect them. Next. Next to the resurrection of Jesus, the area that I do the most work in is near-death experiences. I'm a peer reviewer for the only peer-reviewed near-death journal in the world, not a Christian journal, Journal of Near-Death Studies out of University of Virginia. And I'll just say that this is probably the single most evidential category of things happening today. And I just have to leave it at that. But this has all come about in the last 40 years. So the world is full of things going on. And I think I date myself, as I said yesterday, by citing Simon Garfunkel. I'll do it again today, because as the 60s song says, too often we're looking for love in all the wrong places. Christians will go around and say, how come God's not active? How come God's not meeting my needs? How come God's ignoring me? And someone says, did you ever hear of this? Nope. Did you ever hear of that? Nope. How about that? No, I really haven't. This is pretty intriguing. How about that? Oh yeah, I've read some things on that, but have you heard this kind yet? No. Why is it that we're not aware of what's going on, and yet we pontificate on what God's doing and not doing? And there's a lot of other things besides these. The lecture I'm giving has 9 categories where God's, I believe, supernaturally alive today in measurable ways. So first of all, just to say, we need to solve the problem of why you think he's ignoring you, but God's not ignoring the world. That's my first point. Okay, second, there's a second category. Some people say, okay, enough. I don't need evidence. I'm not like that. I just would like to get a letter, using the example of the shack. I would like to get a letter in my mailbox with a heavenly postmark. I would just like to hear from God personally. I don't care if it's evidence. I just want him to do something in my life. Now, so I have some questions for you, because I think we, again, look for love in all the wrong places. All right. How many of you, now, we have to be adults here like we were yesterday. I'm going to be the first one to raise my hand. How many of you, during a sermon, during somebody, a good friend who comes and talks to you privately, and you realize you did something, hurt somebody, didn't have any idea, and you just, while the person was talking, the guilt just kept mounting while you heard this person's testimony or while you heard your pastor speak or a certain sort of thing. How many of you have ever been so convicted of a sin, you Christians, that you had to get home, shut yourself in your bedroom, and just get down on your knees right away because the Lord had been dealing with you with a conviction? How many of you? Okay, it looks like at least 50% of the hands have been raised. Now, what if I said to you, that is a personal act of God? Who do you think's convicting you? Your mother? Your father? If you're really, I remember one night, friends came down, I pastored up in Michigan, and they came down to see us in Virginia. And when everybody went to bed, the house was quiet. I was reading a passage of scripture in my quiet time, and I came across a phrase that applied to the four of us, the two couples. And I know these folks really, really well, and they were in the bedroom right across the hall. And I felt like waking them up and saying, This cannot wait till the morning. I am so sorry, as your pastor and friend, I did this to you. So I told him the next morning over breakfast. But I will always remember that night, just how convicted I was. But it didn't occur to me. All I could think about was the conviction. It didn't occur to me that the Lord was dealing with me personally. Don't miss the forest for the trees. The Lord was dealing with me personally. Conviction of sin is a personal act from God to you. Okay, next. How many of you have ever been put in time out by God? A few of you. Okay. I've been there too. Time out is an act of love. In the book of Hebrews, it says, don't be discouraged when God treats you as children, because those whom God loves, God disciplines. But be happy when he disciplines you, because God is dealing with you. Again, don't miss the forest for the trees. Discipline is a personal act of God. Even time out. What do we often hear from psychologists? Children want to be disciplined in a way. I never did, but some children want to be disciplined because they see it as an act of love. And the positive thing behind godly time out is that he loves us. And that's a personal sign. Don't miss the forest for the trees. Next. How many of you have at least one spiritual gift from the Lord? At least one. All right, that one's getting about 70% of you. Did you ever read 1 Corinthians 12? We don't make these things up. You don't automatically get the gift of teaching because you're a professor or a school teacher. These things, Paul tells us, they're personal gifts from the Holy Spirit to you. Love letter. From the Holy Spirit to you. This is for you. God's given it to you. Use it for his glory. But we don't often think, I might think of a spiritual gift as something that makes me work at night when someone calls me with a problem. Oh, wow. Always during Monday Night Football. And I don't look at it as a time to witness. I don't look at it as a time to help somebody. But it is a personal act of God. Don't miss the forest for the trees. Next. We talked a little bit this morning about worship. I have only in the last 20 years have been so moved by certain worship services. Because I was raised in a German Baptist church. Religious experience can be different in a German Baptist church, where I was taught you never touch a woman, and you never touch a man except to shake hands. You don't communicate with people. Someone's sitting there, but you don't often, and it wasn't highly emotional. And I was teasing yesterday as somebody raised their hand, everyone's looking, going, who is that, you know? So later, when I moved out of that sort of situation, I realized, wow, I've never felt like this before, but as I get in the car and drive home, I think, I know I was in God's presence this morning during that worship service. It was so uplifting. I know I was in the presence of God. This is incredible. And then I even made an argument for it. I published an article on this one day. If Scripture argues like this and that and this, and I do this and this and this, and then I find that what he says is going to happen is what happens, why should I be surprised? It's exactly what he told me would happen when these certain things come about. So worship experiences say, I've been in God's presence, but it is a personal act of God. So I want to couch this, the rest of this, my remarks, by saying that this is a world where God is involved evidentially, supernaturally, and secondly, personally. Now keep that in mind. Because whatever you raised your hand for on some of these, or didn't, but, kind of checked the box privately, you know that God's dealing with you. But he doesn't always do exactly what you want, but he is alive and well on planet Earth. So we need to start there before we move on. Dan, I forgot to ask you before I started. What time did we usually go here before for the Q&A?
4.
Till 4?
I'm kidding.
Okay. Pardon? Oh. Okay. All right. Let's go to the next one. Here's my first thought. I'm going to miss the Packer game this afternoon. Okay. answers to prayer. My wife and I used to keep a prayer journal. We kept it for 2 years, and we found that 67%, it was odd that it worked just out to that percentage, 67% of the things we prayed for over 2 years, we were a member of an adult group that just shared all kinds of prayer requests. So our little journal was pretty thick. And we counted after that time. And we count about 67% of answers to prayer, personal answers to prayer. I don't mean the supernatural kind, but just some of them were incredible. And just to know that God spoke, God dealt with us, is another way to say God's not just alive in the universe, he's personally dealing with myself or my family or my daughter or my father or my, you know, like that. So let's keep that as a backdrop. But I need to move on to this issue of people who all of us at some time think that God's ignoring us. Okay. I'm telling you guys this, but I'm not trying to argue that there's so many, there are a lot of these events, but I'm not trying to say that this is the normal way God works. Miracles, by definition, are rare. So I'm not trying to say the minute you walk out of church this morning, start looking for love in all the right places because you're going to find 100 of them today. I'm not saying that. I'm saying treasure the ones you come across. Maybe write them down in a prayer journal. I'm amazed by that old song on prayer and count your blessings. Name them one by one, and it will surprise you what the Lord has done. I'm amused that we're surprised, but I think one of the reasons we're surprised is because we forget the positive things. We're like little kids, and we forget the positive things, and we're pretty ungrateful toward God. And we remember the things he didn't answer, and we really conveniently forget the things. Like a child, you're praying for a child, and the child's ill. And this could be a bad one, but it could be an okay one. And tomorrow, child's better. And you go, well, that's what the doctor said anyway. And you conveniently forget, but you forget the fear you were in the day before. Just overlook it. And I think we forget how much God speaks, again, not supernaturally so much, but just to me. Okay, but remember, God doesn't always do that. So in the times when you're not seeing him doing that, you have to kind of balance both sides together, all right? All right, I'm going to give two objections from the side of those who feel they're being ignored by God. And the first objection goes like this. What about my favorite verses? Here's all I want to know. When I was taught in Sunday school as a little child or later to memorize verses, what kind of verses am I going to memorize? Well, one popular answer to that is promises. I'm going to memorize things where God makes promises. And I've memorized certain texts, and it just seems like God doesn't measure up to some of these things. Now, here's a couple examples. Three times in John 14, 15, and 16, Jesus makes some of the most incredible comments concerning fulfilled answered prayer. Pray whatever you want in my name, and you'll get it. And then he says again, whatever, pray. And you'll receive it. How about the one in James chapter 5? Someone's sick? Call the elders. Let them anoint the person with prayer. And the prayer of faith will heal the person. And so the person goes, excuse me? I mean, I know God's alive and well, but either James 5 says God will heal, or James 5 does not say that. But if it says God will heal, I want to know why he didn't. Now, when my wife was dying in 1995 with stomach cancer, we were up at University of Virginia Hospital, about an hour from our house, and the elders from our church came up to the hospital and anointed her with oil and prayed. 4 months later, almost to the day, she died. What does James 5 say? And what about those promises in John? Okay, what do you say? That's the objection. Didn't God say? Didn't God promise? Let's look at the next one. All right, here's three things for you to keep in mind. The first one, what do you do with contrary comments? I'm just asking you, what do you do with contrary comments in Scripture? For example, the book in the Bible that has the most claims about healing is the book of Psalms. And the book in the Bible, maybe just because it's so large, But the book in the Bible that says the most about God not answering prayer and God not people not being able to find God when they want him is the book of Psalms. How do you weigh verses that say, I will heal, and verses that say, even in the days of David, I don't know, I look for God, he's not around? Because there are some rough passages in Psalms, if you want to be unedified, but it's in God's word. So read Psalm 44 sometime. It just, I bet you didn't know it was there. Or if you read it, it just didn't dawn on you what was going on. But the psalmist says this, we're your people. You crush us all the time. Now, I know what you're thinking. It's because we break your promises. But we're not breaking your promises. We're not. We've been obedient, and you still crush us. We die for your sake, just because you want us to die. And then the verse says this, wake up and come and save us. And the psalm ends. Wake up? Well, God can't sleep. Remember I said about the attributes of God? God can't be un-God. And God can't be disconnected with his creation, and he can't sleep because he can't do things that are un-God. But the psalmist says, wake up. And there's a lot of passages that cry out like that. So my first comment to you is, if you think you've got this all down, because there's three nice verses in John, and you're right, there are three verses in John. There's a tough verse in James 5. What do you do when there are contrary? What do you do with books that balance both the answers and the promises and the warnings in the same text? It maybe the conclusion isn't quite as simple as we thought. Okay, second point. What do you do about the media context? Okay, let's look at each one of these. I gave you the verses for the promises. Here's the same exact context, okay, of the promises. Here's one. John 15, verse 20. Jesus says, if they persecuted me, they will persecute you also. What? I thought you just said whatever we pray for, we'll get it. Yeah. Don't pray for the end of persecution, though, because you're going to be persecuted. Whoa. Whoa, I didn't sign up for persecution when I came to Christ. But the same context that promises answers to all your prayers three times says you're going to be persecuted. Same context. All right, here's another one. John 16, 2. Same text. He says that you're going to be suffering. You're going to be suffering in your service to God. You go, well, can I pray that I don't suffer? No, you're going to suffer. What did you mean by I can have everything I want? How about this one? Last verse in John 16. In this world, you will have trouble, but take heart. I've overcome the world. Well, I'm really glad you've overcome the world, but why am I going to have trouble when you said I could pray for anything I want? Three times, Jesus says, whatever you want, pray for it, you'll get it. And three times in the exact same context, he says you're going to have issues. In fact, he says once that people are going to think they're doing God a favor when they kill you. I thought I could pray for whatever I want. Lord, please don't let them kill me. And you said I could have whatever I want. No, you're going to be going through persecution. They're going to be killing you. Now, the next chapter in John maybe has the answer. This is the so-called high priestly prayer of Christ. Jesus is alone with his Father. And here's maybe a hint. Jesus is praying in John 7, 14 and 15. And he says, I pray not that you take them out of the world, but that you protect them in the world. And I started thinking about this. How do we get these two together? What if answers to prayer mean, see, we assume in the West that an answer to prayer means God takes us from the situation. Earlier we got the question about persecution. I said it was coming up in this message. What if praying doesn't mean removed from the situation? What if answering your prayer means God holds your hand through the situation? Because how do I get answer your prayer, answer your prayer, answer your prayer three times, and how do I get persecute, die, and troubles three times in the exact same passage? Maybe we assume God's let us down because the assumption is he didn't take me away from it. And maybe Jesus is saying, I never promised to take you away from it. In fact, let me tell you something. In the New Testament, almost always the person didn't get taken away from it. Read Hebrews 11 sometime with all the problems that people went through in the Old Testament. Women who didn't receive their sons and husbands back because they were killed and they stayed firm to the Lord. They were looking for a city whose builder maker was God, and the prophets who died. And Hebrews 11, we often call it the Hall of Faith, but it's a series of people who had a lot of nasty things happen to them. I don't read in Scripture that God ever says, I will take you away from all your troubles. But I read where God says, I'll never leave you or forsake you. He says, I'll be with you in them. How about the other tough one? How about James chapter 5? Does it say that God will heal? Let's go one more. How about the contrast with the same author in the book? What do you do with James 5? Well, let me tell you an example. Because I deal with doubt, and I've written three books on the subject, including one on the silence thing, which is on the back table. People write to me, and I have no idea who they are, and they've read something of mine. And one day I got this email, and I've only done this like twice in my life, but I got this email, and I said to my wife, I want you to see this email. You've got to read it. And here's how the email went. The woman said, I live in Chicago. I'm a young mother, or I thought I was going to be. And I was pregnant. And there was a problem with the baby. And I was told that it was touch and go whether my baby was going to live or die. And she said, I go to a charismatic church. In fact, I'm a lay person, but I direct the lay program in visitation here. So I've been working for the Lord, and I go out and I lead groups of people out, and we witness, and I'm pregnant, and the baby's coming. And one of the elders in my church said he had been praying for me, and he walked up to me and said, I've been given a word for you from the Lord. Your baby's going to be okay. She said, only my baby wasn't okay. My baby died. Now, sometimes they do this in hospitals. Maybe you've seen this, but this is one of the toughest things I've ever seen. When the baby died, they actually took a photo of the mother and the deceased baby, all dressed up. The baby was all dressed up, but the baby was dead. And she was holding the baby in her arm in the hospital bed, and she sent me the photo. It's to help with the grieving process, I understand. But she sent me the photo, and she said, why did God let me down? We called the elders, James chapter 5. One of the elders said he heard from the Lord. He said, my baby would be fine. My baby's not fine. If you have, she goes, oh, needless to say, I no longer direct the witnessing program. Notice the volitional doubt here, for those of you who were last hour. I no longer direct that program. I'm a little upset with God right now. He and I aren't getting along. If you have any guts, you'll call me. Here's my number. My wife came in and read it, and she went, whoa. And then she goes, better call her, and turned around and walked out of the study. All right. I called her, and we talked. Our first phone call, we talked for 4 hours. And this was her most pointed question. I only want to know one thing, she asked me. Does your Bible have James 5 in it? And does your Bible say the prayer of faith will heal? That's all I want to know. Is James 5 in your Bible? And without a pause, immediately, this is what I said back to her. I'll answer you if you answer me a question. Does your Bible have James 1 in it? I didn't even tell her what James 1 was, and it was to her credit that she knew what I was getting at. And she said, I said, does your Bible have James 1 in it? And she said, oh, no, I never thought of that. You know how James starts? Count it all joy when you fall into problems and you have issues, because God's going to work them out in your life, and let it have its path, and it's going to be rough for a while, but it's going to grow, and you're going to come out being mature and you're going to be better for it. Now, here's my question. She just want to know, is James 5 in the Bible? Yes, it is. And it's a hard passage, and my wife died too. But James 1 is also there. And James says, let me just paraphrase him. James, in order to have James 1, James has got to be saying, it's not always going to work out. Because you're going to have issues, let it take its course, and you'll be a more mature believer. Well, I thought you said all we had to do was call the elders and use the oil. Not always. How do you get James 1 with James 5? I'm not sure. I can honestly tell you that. I don't know. There are some rough texts. But it can't mean that the problems will always be solved, because James 1 says you're always going to have problems and let them work themselves out. I can't put the three, ask your prayers and get whatever you want, and with Jesus, with the three in the same context, you're going to be persecuted, killed, and have problems throughout your life. And then the very next chapter, he prays that God not take us out of the world, but that he bless us and hold our hand basically through the problems. So the first lie, as per what we called lies yesterday, the first thing we have to deal with here is, what do we say to ourselves? And here's how pernicious our words are to ourselves. I started by saying, when you go, oh no, you know what oh no means. I thought I had a day off tomorrow, and they say I got to come into work for half a day. I can't believe it. But all that's rolled up, and you know what that means. Well, when we feed ourselves wrong things, we learn wrong things. Because like I said yesterday, I would never lie to me, so I must not be lying to me. I must be telling the truth. All right, now here's the issue. If I say, God promised always to heal, but he broke his promises to me, here's what, get this point, it's so important. If I say that, for me, God's a liar. In my mind, the way I think about it, God's a liar. God's a promise breaker. God let me down. It's not true, but that's what he is in my mind, because I tell myself that. Now, if somebody breaks a promise to you, are you happy with them? They break a promise to you a lot, would you probably not hang around with them quite so much? Would they not be your best friend anymore? They lied to you? Would you probably not hang around with them so much? What happens when God breaks promises and lies? Well, he doesn't do that, but you think he does. You tell yourself he does. You know what means. God did it again. What happens? He's not going to be my best friend anymore. And if I miss devotions this week, he had it coming. Look what he did to me. And the distance starts growing. It's the you stay in your half of the universe and I'll stay in mine type of thing. But notice what happened? It's not real. It's perceived. But because you're perceiving it, it's truth to you. That's why one of the worst things you can do, we talked yesterday about A's, B's, and C's. Well, God let my child die. That's an A. The A is the baby died. B is what it means. God let me down, I'll no longer direct visitation in our church. God let me down when the elder said my baby was going to live. God's to blame. Those are not true. But they're true for you. So they're going to start germinating. If you tell yourself lies, you'll live lies, and your distance with God will grow. So if you say, God doesn't care about me, he doesn't love me, those are lies, but for you, they will be true. And you'll live like they're true. And when you think of God, you'll have a bad view of him, but it's all self-concocted. It's in your mind. It's your picture. It's my picture. All right? So what about my favorite verses? Doesn't solve the issue. Because what do you do about contrary verses? What do you do about the same context? What do you do about books where James 1 doesn't jive with James 5? I did give you an idea of how you could get them together. That God doesn't mean I will always heal the person, but God means I'll hold your hand through it. Because the Bible talks a lot about going through your issues. 2 Corinthians 1, verses 3 to 5. The God who takes us through things so that we'll be able to talk other people through things. That doesn't sound like a life where there's no issues. All right, how about a second objection? But I wished I lived in New Testament times. Didn't God always swoop down and take these people away from the issues? Didn't he always just come in and do a miracle? I've never seen a miracle. But he always did one. Notice the way I'm talking to myself? He always did it then. He never does it now. He's letting me down. My comments are leading me to more false views, but I believe me, so I've got bad theology. Let me tell you something. God almost never takes believers away from tough situations in the New Testament. Almost never. Now, I was doing this lecture one time, and a lady during the Q&A, she raised her hand, she goes, I've got a case for you where God took somebody away. And I said, well, look, I said, I'm not saying there's never one. There are a few in the New Testament, but there's very few. I said, but which one do you have in mind? She said, Acts 17, Paul and Silas are thrown into prison, and they prayed and sang hymns, and the door sprang open, and they got out scot-free, and they went to the jailer who was ready to kill himself, and ended up leading the jailer to the Lord, and the jailer took them home, and the whole family believed and was baptized. And I said, why did the jailer take them home? What happened to Paul and Silas before they were put in the jail? So, they were beaten. They were whipped. If you were Paul, what would you be saying to yourself between the first and the second whip, the second and the third and the fourth and the fifth and the sixth? What would you have said? Lord, please take me. Okay, Lord, please, no more. Please take me. Lord, can you please step in right now? Does that sound like somebody who's been removed from it? She said, oh, I forgot about that part. Now, there is one in Acts 13 where the angel comes and gets Peter out, and that's one of the only ones where nothing happens. Let's talk about our Lord, for example. As nearly as I can tell, there are 8 incidents in Jesus' life where tough things happen where, humanly speaking, it would be convenient if his father took him away from them. He never gets away from a single one. Now, there is one, you could argue it's an exception. When Jesus was a little baby, Joseph has a dream. People are trying to kill him, take him away, and they took Jesus to Egypt. Jesus got away. But tell that to the mothers and fathers that lost the babies back in the town. Jesus got away, but they didn't. What about those deaths of those little babies? And in no other incident is Jesus taken away. He's in the garden. Luke, the doctor, says, it looks like it was sweat drops of blood. We know that what that is. There's a name for it. And it's caused by extreme anxiety. And the capillaries start leaking the blood. That's how much Jesus was suffering. How about the beating before the crucifixion? When Mel Gibson's movie first came out, I've done a lot of work on the Shroud of Turin, a couple of co-authored books. I heard that Mel Gibson was using the shroud. And I thought, during the movie, first time I saw it, I thought, this is going to be bad. Because I know that the fellow in the shroud has been whipped on every inch of his body, with the exception of his face, his forearms, and his feet. So when they were whipping Jesus' back in the movie, I knew they were going to turn him over, because the man in the shroud was whipped across the chest and the thighs and the calves. And sure enough, in one of his twisting and turning from the whipping, Jesus flips over and they start whipping his chest and his stomach and his legs. Did the Father take him away? He rescued him from the Garden of Gethsemane, right? How about on the cross? We so downplay the words, my God, why have you forsaken me? How did the Son of God feel forsaken? What's another way to say that? Silence. The silence problem occurred to the Son of God. Where are you when I need you most? And he died. He wasn't taken from it. So I don't think there's a lot of help. There's some real interesting passages, but I don't think there's a lot of help going to my favorite verses. And I don't think there's a lot of help. There's almost no help asking about what happens in the New Testament. Because here, Jesus doesn't get out of it. He dies. All right, let me ask you a couple questions. We're getting down toward the end here. Two considerations. All right, Hebrews 5:8 is a staggering verse to me. We know the verse, just a chapter removed from this, tested at all points like as we yet without sin. But how can we not talk about this verse? Although he was a son, he learned obedience from what he suffered. What? First of all, we don't really have a place for saying Jesus learned anything. Last verse of Luke 2 says he grew in wisdom and stature. Jesus learned. He was a human being. And he learned obedience from what he suffered. All right, here's my first question for us. Do we learn faster than Jesus learned? Jesus was spurred on by his suffering to learn obedience. Can we learn it faster than the Son of God without the suffering? That's pretty staggering. Second question. Hebrews 2 says that the author of salvation was made perfect through suffering. All right, first question is, do we learn faster than Jesus? Second question is, are we perfected more than Jesus without suffering? Jesus needed it, learned by it, was perfected through it, and we say, sorry, I don't need the perfecting and the learning. I just as soon skip it off. But if we think we're going to use Jesus as an example with our favorite verses or by citing, didn't God always take people away from the New Testament? He virtually never does. So I would say that until we can answer these two considerations, if we don't deserve it more than Jesus, and if we don't learn more quickly than Jesus, I mean, what's our point? God's letting me suffer. And? Well, he always took people away from the New Testament. Really? After my wife died in 1995, I pictured, and I've published this make-believe dialogue several places, but I pictured, I went on my front porch because my wife was sleeping 17, 18 hours a day, and I had the kids were in school, and I had a kitty monitor up in the room, and she had stomach cancer, so I had to change the, she had a tube in her stomach, and I had to feed her through the tube three times a day and give her four rounds of medicine. Then I'd take the tubes out, and three of my daughters are nurses, so I really appreciate what they do. But I'd take the tubes out every day and run vinegar water through them, put the tubes back in, and run the food machines. And I was exhausted, and I would go out on the front porch periodically and just sit there, and I pictured having a conversation with God, sort of a Job 38 sort of time. If you remember Job 38? Job came to, the Lord came to Job and asked him these tough questions. And I was, the way my conversation with God was something like this. I would say, Lord, why is Debbie up there dying in the bedroom? She's 43 years old and I have four kids here. And the youngest one is 9 years old. And Lord, you've given me a ministry to do, but I can't do my ministry. Because I'm getting the kids up in the morning, I'm making their lunches, the food has to be ready at night, someone has to do their wash, and my wife's dying, my best friend, she's dying. And I pictured the Lord saying back to me, Gary, I know what you're going through. I watched my son die. Gary, Did you ever think that I answered his prayer on the cross? You what? I answered his prayer? What do you mean you answered his prayer? He died. I know, but I answered his prayer. I raised him from the dead on Sunday morning. I said, Lord, that's not an answer to prayer. He died. Oh, no. Are you telling me Debbie has to die? I can't handle this. And I pictured the Lord going on and saying to me, based on what, you should read Job 38. I kind of based it on that dialogue. And I pictured the Lord saying to me, Gary, look, I watched my son die. I raised him. And one day you're going to be in heaven with your wife. You know, the card that moved me the most that I got after my wife passed away, when I finally put the cards away and it was obvious that I was going to get married again, I put these, my mother and my wife were best friends. That's pretty good for a mother-in-law. And she said to me, she said, it's time to put the pictures away. It's time to put the cards up, you know, away. And so I was putting them away, and the card I left on top was a card that I could not even repeat to people for about a year. But it said this. It said, imagine the day when you're going to be in heaven with your loved one, and you're going to walk down the streets of heaven hand in hand with your beloved. I thought, oh, I can't read this. I can't get all the way through the card. But it was great. It touched my heart. And I was reminded regularly that that's the kind of world we live in. Christians aren't exempt from suffering, but they weren't exempt from suffering in the early church. And the Son of God wasn't exempt from suffering. And I think God would have taken me by the hand and said, if you have to know, Debbie's going to die. But I got your back. And Lord, how? My mother called it, she said, that my wife experienced dying grace. Here's what my mom calls dying grace. She said, he gives all believers dying grace, but you won't have it until you die. So don't wonder about what it's going to be like. You won't know it till you need it. And she said, Debbie taught all of us how to live, and Debbie taught us how to die. And like I said, they were best friends. The Bible never exempts Christians from suffering. I don't always know what to do with your favorite verses, but I do know that it doesn't mean what I think it means, because the immediate context and the immediate book tells me that's not the kind of thing I'm talking about, that I'm not promising you a problem-free world. John 14 to 16, three of these and three of these. James 5, but there's also James 1. That's the way Scripture works. But the worst thing I can do is lie to myself. The worst thing I can do is say some of the following. God doesn't care. God never cares. He always leaves me like this. And then you get together, you need a couple buddies who kind of commiserate with you and lie to you too, right? Yeah, I know. I had a problem like that once and God let me down too. Great. That's just the edification we need. But we keep saying those things to ourselves, and our theology gets worse and worse and worse. Because you remember, bad bees will mold your life, you'll believe them, and the depression, the anxiety, the anger that come from your bad bees, they are self-induced. It's self-induced. God didn't give it to you. It's not biblical. And you have no reason to be upset with God. You don't. Jesus didn't. And you know, I have always had a feeling that God would only need about a sentence, and then we'd say, oh, I never thought of that. That works it all out. But the resurrection, with all its evidences, the resurrection says there is an answer. And the things we started the lecture with, the reasons to believe God's alive and well today, says there is an answer. And all those personal things says God speaks to us. So it's a lie to say that God doesn't care. It's a lie to say that God's ignoring us. There is a response. And many other times he doesn't ignore us when he answers other prayers. And when he gives you spiritual gifts. And when he gives you time out. And when he convicts you of sin. He's not ignoring you. It's just that we want it right there on the spot, or we'll never admit any of the other ones work. And that's just wrong. It's just a bad argument. So, as we end this, I think one way to my best shot at doing the text is that God doesn't take us from problems. He takes us through them. He holds our hand through them. One time I was teaching a class, and I had a third world gal in class. And she kind of challenged the whole class. And she said, I got a question for you Western folks who think God's like a slot machine and you put your nickel in, you get a candy bar, or you go to fast foods and you get your food right away. She said, she might have been from Haiti or from the Bahamas. And she said, why do you think we have so many children in our families? I don't know. Don't know what birth control is? I don't know. We have all these smart aleck kind of responses. And she said, we have so many children because half of them die. And the other half become the parents' life insurance policy when they get to be old. She said, we live in a world where things happen. We're not tempted to say God ignores us because we see it in an everyday world. Who tells you folks that you don't have to go through any of it, that you can live without it? She says, that's a Western idea. That's not an Eastern idea. And that's not a biblical idea. And we sort of sat there like, and I thought she made really good sense. We require that God be a certain way because that's how our world is. And we want it all like that. And we think we've got verses to back us up, but it can't be because he didn't act like that in the New Testament. He doesn't act like that today. Let's go on here. I'm just about done. Lessons. Here's some things for you to think about. Learn God's truth and don't emphasize one angle over another one. When God puts you in time out, celebrate that. When he convicts you of a sin, that's a personal love letter from God. Collect your love letters, write them down, remind yourself of them, and then you're less likely to think God's abandoned you when something else doesn't work. Okay? Be careful to say what we do, what we say to ourselves, because when you blame God, you're causing emotional problems that are not based on anything in Scripture. You think they are, but they're not. I think they are, but they're not. And I've made problems for myself, psychological problems that are going to come, anger, depression, anxiety. They're going to rise, and guess what? For the sake of saying I don't want to hurt, I'm causing myself to hurt twice as much. How logical is that? So we should clean up what we say to ourselves, clean up our words, not lie to ourselves. God does not ignore us. There's so many indications that he doesn't. He's alive. He's well. He answers our problems. Not always the way we want, but he promised to be with us. And that's the promise of Scripture, and that's what these evidences and that's what this reality says.
You left the contradiction in John unresolved. That's a little worrisome.
What contradiction?
Well, where he says, no matter what you pray for, you'll get it, and the rest of it where people were persecuted, and presumably some of them prayed not to be. I mean, that's worrisome.
Okay, I'm not sure I understand what you're asking. I left what issue? I understand I left an issue. Pardon? That Jesus said three times, whatever you ask will happen, and three times he said you're going to have issues. Why? I guess what I was thinking is that necessarily a contradiction? Two things cannot both be and not be in the same time, same place, same manner. Is Jesus talking about both of them in the same time, same place, same manner? What if, like I suggested, what if in the next chapter he says, I don't pray that you take them out of the world, I pray that you protect them in the world. What if the answer is the escape he's talking about is blessing, hope, presence, God holding your hand, not the escaping the problems, and that he modeled that answer himself in his own life where he never got away from anything? I do admit, there are issues here. Anybody who tries to struggle with this is not just a black, white, real easy, oh yeah, we'll solve it this way. No matter which way you go, there's gonna be issues. But like I said, since in the same context there are exceptions, since in the same book there are exceptions, and since in other books, I gotta think maybe my understanding of answered is not the same as Jesus' understanding of answered.
No, and speaking of the silence of God, where in part does the will of God act within those two areas, the extreme on the one side and the extreme on the other? Does that make sense where he says, well, I promise you whatever you ask, it'll be given to you. And then where the persecution, the suffering that comes into play, because I can ask for, please take me, keep me from suffering, but if I encounter that suffer, is God's will a part of that, or does he just not care, I guess? I don't know. Something like that. That makes sense? Because I'm just thinking, you know, because if you have, you know, I just think of, well, what's God's will in this? You know, if I'm going through the suffering, is this part of God's will for me to mature, whatever that part is, or do we just not add God's will into that at all?
I mean, I think you can, but if you don't know what God's will is exactly, it's hard to plug that into the equation. But there are many passages of Scripture. James 1 is one of them. But there are many passages of Scripture that say that one of the chief points of suffering is to grow, to be more mature, to be able to help others through it. I mean, that's 2 Corinthians 1, that's Galatians 1. It's in Jesus' teachings too. So it's in enough passages that I think that might be one of the reasons God says, in effect, God says no to you, you know, to take you through it. Because that's just like timeout's designed for you, and just like conviction of sin is designed for you, and just like blessings are designed for you, maybe suffering's designed for you. Maybe it's just the way the Christian life is. I know I've had to ask that question many, many times with regard to my wife. And I never thought I had an adequate answer of why I went through what she did. But then I realized, let's say God had answered me. What good would that have done? All right, she died young because, okay. All right, so now I know the reason. Is she still going to die young? Yep. You know, I could say, philosophical viewpoint, I could say it's due to a libertarian view of free will where free creatures can act, and read Alvin Plantinga's God, Freedom, and Evil. You know, seriously, for someone who teaches philosophy professionally, I would say something like that. I would start talking about what free will is and what choices we make and how this all works together, because I think it works together very nicely. And you know what? I did some publishing, as I told you, about the Job 38 thing, about this make-believe discussion with God. I did some publishing on this with one of my doubt things I did 3 years before my wife died. And so when she was dying, I was able to think through this, and I think God protected me from a lot of pain in this sense. This doesn't make my view of free will and God's will correct, but because of my view of free will, I didn't think God caused any of it. So that was also, I wondered, what about, see, a buddy of mine who's a real strong Calvinist, the same time my wife was dying, his wife was dying. And he was asking different questions than I was. He was asking, why was God letting him down? In fact, he later wrote a book called Deceived by God? But I didn't look at it that way. I didn't look like God had sent anything. I looked at it like things happen in the world. And anyway, that's about the only way I respond to what you're saying. I don't have any other specific comments.
I know that most of your talk has been on personal situations, but I was curious, is there a collective answer to prayer and blessings, for instance, for a country or a certain people or a denomination?
A collective answer.
Does a country get blessed? Does a country get answered to prayer?
Oh, you know, in the book on the Why Is God Ignoring Me, I have a chapter on conditions for prayer as set out through Scripture. And one of them is, one text in the Old Testament says, I didn't answer your prayers because your nation was so much at odds with me. They had turned me off. And so, and I think, what about our nation? I do think there's some relevant things. I do think God sometimes makes decisions that are far beyond the parameters of my life, this church, my town. You know, it could be like what's going on in the U.S. It could be, you know, I'm fearful for our country. I really, really am. And that text says God sometimes makes decisions based on how people respond as a nation.
Yeah. Or the people of Israel.
Sometimes Israel too, yeah. And Israel as a people, as opposed to as an individual, has also gone through suffering, almost like corporately. You know, so yeah, I think that's taught in Scripture too.
Something the Lord gave me when our 15 and a half year old son died was to honor him while in the fire.
Honor him?
While in the fire. So looking to what might happen in our country, I just need to say we all need to be strong in him and work as unto the Lord in all that we do. But showing others how we honor him while we're in the fire.
Did you notice during those times, I was distinctly aware that people were watching to see how I responded, because I'm a professor at a Christian school, or you might be an elder at this church, or you might be a this at that, and I had to be real careful what I said and how I responded, and I was real careful during those times. And I also stopped because of some of these passages, and I would say, you know, is there any way I can ascertain what God is trying to teach me through this or that? That was all. You know what? You know how sometimes we get a little too theoretical. Teaching philosophy and having taught some seminars on death and dying way before my wife got sick, I even asked myself, while my wife was dying, I was going through Kubler-Ross's stages, asking which stage I was at. That's a little too theoretical. I mean, you know, to be asking myself such stupid things while she was upstairs. But I was just trying to see where I was and what I was going through. It's just, and all those things have been discredited today anyway, so. Pardon? Yeah, well, there are ups and downs, that's for sure.
Doesn't looking for an answer where God may not give us an answer create the doubt itself?
It could, but I think the doubt comes from what I say to myself. Mm. I think that's the, I do think we have to be open to, I'm never going to get an answer to this, because right now I still don't have a clue why it happened. But you know what? I really don't feel I need that answer. It wouldn't have changed anything. It would make nothing better. In fact, I might have made something worse. So I'm kind of glad I never got one. You know, I was just thinking about you folks and talking about your child. When my wife died, my mom said to me, real interesting, after it was over, she said, people are going to be watching you, but you know what? She said, you're in a good place. You're not going to be able to make a mistake for 1 year, because everybody will write it off to your grief. I thought, that's really provocative. So if a couple asked me to go out to dinner, or if this happened or that happened, I would just be real bold and I would ask them things. And during that time, there were only two people who I thought shared my level of pain. Only two kinds of people. Someone who'd lost a spouse or someone who'd lost a child. I thought nobody else compared the level of pain. And a young lady walked up to me in the hallway. I didn't even know who she was. She walked in the hallway at the university and she said, didn't your wife just die? And I said, she did. And she said, I know what you're going through. My aunt died last week. I said, she said, I'm praying for you. And I said, thank you for your prayers. And I walked away and I said to myself, she doesn't have a clue, you know, to say, yeah, my aunt died last week. You know, you just think those things. But I remember thinking that. And one thing for you couples, Generally, when I ask people over dinner during the next year, what would be the most painful death for you to take in your life? The men almost always said their wives. And about half the time, the wife said their husband. That's probably because he was sitting there. And the other half, she said, one of my children. But the husband almost always said her, and she only said him about half the time. That's interesting. This children, I've had a lot of discussions with men since then about this dynamic in marriage between a mother and a child and a husband and a wife. And I also, a lesson comes out of this. If you're real close in your marriage and you guys are best friends and you get along real well, it just, you know, when you're in the fire, it just allows you to say to people, you know, you never know what you got till it's gone. And sometimes it happens fast. So just enjoy every minute. I wish I had a lot more of them.
I was just going to make a comment about the time out. I always took God's time out for me as, well, I think I must be doing things right because I can count on him to get in there and redirect me if I start doing something wrong. So I'm just going to take this time out as the go ahead and go forward, just continue doing what I'm doing.
So if you haven't had one for a year, you must be doing all right, huh?
Yeah. And then my other thought was about Christian suffering here in the West. I think that we think, you know, of suffering as real, you know, physical attack or whatever like that. But I'm noticing that there is like an underground current of hatred towards Christians. And out in public, you are really, or I've noticed I have been admonished for saying the word Jesus or Christ. That's, you know, a no-no. So there is like this covert suppression that is pressed on Christians, and that is kind of like a suffering.
Oh,
to yeah. To me anyway.
Sure. When Jesus talks in the Sermon on the Mount, he said, "Blessed are you when people say all manner of false things against you." So again, blessings are one reason we go through things, but he specifically says when people say things against you. So hurtful things are definitely a type of persecution, according to Jesus.
One thing that I've always considered in this business of doubt, if you haven't figured out why he's not answering your prayer, it could be that he's answering somebody else's prayer that may be in conflict with your prayer, and that he's looking at the big picture. You're looking very myopically at your own self-interest, and I use that in quotes advisedly, but Billy Graham's wife was supposedly said that if God had answered all my prayers, I would have married the wrong man four times.
Good point.
You know, I listened to all this, and I have to say, I feel like I've grown quite a bit in the last couple of years. I look at what's happening, and I have just learned trust. And I think trust is the answer to all of this. It's God teaching us to trust him more. When you pray for something, trust he will answer it in the way that he sees fit. I actually knew a lady like you, actually kept that diary for 10 years. And when she went back after 10 years, her prayer request was up in the 90th percentile. Just took a little longer. So things don't always get answered the way you want them to, but I think when we pray for something, we pray for it. We do what we can. If we're gonna pray for something, for instance, for the election, we go vote, and then we trust that God will answer our prayer in his way, and that it will be for the glorification of God. It's not gonna be for our glory, it will be for him. And if just have to trust that he knows the right thing to do.
He even says, my ways are not your ways. As the heaven is above the earth, so are my ways above your ways. I have to remind myself of that a lot.
Let's take maybe two more questions. Anybody else?
I don't have any doubt whatsoever, 100% certainty, that I can walk across this room. James 5 says that faith will allow you to, God will answer your prayers if you have faith. And it seems like faith might be defined in that section as knowing without doubt. And there were some successes in the studies, and there are individual successes, and what Mr. Nelson just pointed out, you've got to trust. Maybe to get a successful healing or answer to one's prayers, you have to know without doubt, 100% certain. And it's so difficult for a human being to achieve that state that that's the reason for all the failures. And maybe you could comment on that.
That if we don't believe with 100%, what we pray for is not going to happen?
Yes, that's maybe the difference in between the successes and the failures. I know without doubt I can walk across the room, and so I can.
Yeah. I have a lot of issue myself with that interpretation. I mean, I see people, the one I talked about, was it yesterday? The man who came to Jesus and said, Lord, I believe, help thou my unbelief, and Jesus went ahead and did what he asked. So I do know that God answers prayer for people who don't have, that complete lack of doubt. And I think there's other examples like that too. I think it's
maybe God didn't answer that one. Maybe it just happened for another reason.
Well, he did say he was going to answer the, he did say he would perform the healing. So I think about that. I also think about this have it, say it sort of movement today. You can have what, and I don't see that anywhere in scripture. So I think it's kind of dangerous to try to trump up our faith so that we're at the 100% mark, so that all the engines are revved up and I'm ready to ask this and I'm just right. It puts a horrible burden on the individual, of guilt and everything else because I fell short of that. We're human beings. We're not gonna make it to the 100% mark. We what if ourselves to death. So I think that's gonna be the very, very rare person who's gonna be like that. So I just have issues myself with what that does to people and how God answers things when people are not 100%. There's other examples besides that healing.